This episode of The Patch is sponsored by Hulu Plus. Hulu Plus lets you binge on thousands of hit shows anytime, anywhere on your TV, PC, smartphone, or tablet. Support this podcast and get an extended free trial of Hulu Plus when you go to HuluPlus.com/patch. That's HuluPlus.com/patch.
Hello, everyone.
Everybody.
Welcome to The Patch.
Welcome.
This
to
week?
The Patch.
Welcome.
Gus, Burnie, Ashley, Gus. So I want to start off by saying this episode is pre-taped. We're going to be busy filming other things on Wednesday. So we sadly will not be able to interact via Twitter.
Secret
but we'll be here to
what
talk.
What will we be filming?
I don't know if I can say.
What's that?
I don't know if I can say.
Probably shouldn't say.
We're filming.
Because it's immersion.
So nonetheless, we're here to talk about video games as we do every week. And we've got a list of topics to cover. I felt like the list was a little lighter than normal this week.
Are you kidding me? That list that we compiled was pretty long. I'm looking at it right now.
There's some good stuff to talk about in there.
We've
had longer.
Are you kidding? Like in January
we
had longer?
That's true.
In comparison to last week, so we were trying to get through 2 weeks of news. It's going to seem a little bit slow, but we'll actually have time to talk about things and argue, and it's going to be a lot of fun.
Yay. I love arguing.
Yeah, I know you do.
So, first bit of news that I have listed here is, I guess, there's a new trailer for BioShock Infinite's upcoming DLC, Burial at Sea Part 2. I don't know if you've seen it. I guess it's the beginning cinematic, maybe?
So that would have come out this morning.
Was Ashley given the opportunity to rebut our criticism of BioShock Infinite on the Game of the Year podcast?
We discussed it briefly last week, and what it came down to for me is a lot of the criticisms that you made, like the fact that they went from stepping into another world being a big deal to just like, I don't like my shoes this morning. Let's step into another world.
Yeah.
You know, that I think that was a valid criticism. I think that, you know, if that's something you care about, that's makes sense. I think that it should be a big deal to leave. When you get down to it, everything you've ever known and step into a world that you don't know what's going to happen should be a big deal. And it does become decreasingly so. Could be a problem. I didn't think about it while I was playing. I didn't think about it until anyone else pointed it out. It at no point while playing lessened my enjoyment. And in the end, my enjoyment is what I care about.
And you know what?
Y'all can go do what you like.
Fuck you guys. I'm playing my game.
See, and that's part of the reason why we don't criticize a lot, like we don't do video game reviews, and the Game of the Year stuff is the closest we get to it, is that there's a lot of people who really liked it. You got to give credit to Irrational for making a story in a very complex universe, a multiverse, and they told a story that a lot of people were able to digest and they liked it.
Yeah.
And it's like, so to sit there and say the reasons you don't like it, I don't want to ruin anybody else's enjoyment.
It's a beautiful game. I mean, it's a beautiful game.
Yeah.
I think there's fun things about it. It just wasn't my favorite game of the year.
And I think people think that we didn't like BioShock Infinite. I actually really liked BioShock Infinite a lot. You know, I'm not a big fan of the combat.
You played it twice.
I did. And I played on 1999 mode.
Yeah. Just to outdo me in the achievement race. Still a little bit sore about
you
that.
Are you ever going to finish 1999 mode?
No.
There's no reason
like,
to
know. The only reason that I care is because we were having an achievement race. We discussed this last week, too, is that like I don't often 1,000-point games. Because I just don't care. That's not completion to me.
How dare you?
I know. This is an area where we greatly differ, but
way
I just I like it's just not my thing. You know, so I will never complete 1999 mode. It doesn't matter that much to me.
Yeah, what I always say when it comes down to those kinds of achievements is I don't want someone else telling me how to play the game. Like I'm gonna play the game through my experience and that's it. I'm not gonna go back and do stuff I don't want to do.
Okay. That's fair. I get it. So Burial at Sea, the new trailer for the second part of Burial at Sea has come out. Doesn't have a release date on it, but it did show, you know, some narrative spoilers, if you will.
Now, last year when they were initially announcing the Burial at Sea stuff, they did say that they were planning on releasing it quite early. So it's probably going to be next month. I would say March at the latest.
You know, we were just talking about this because there's no dates yet released for the last three lost episodes of Dead Rising 3's lost episodes,
right.
The DLC that they're doing. But from what I understand, that 13 gig patch they put out, I was looking through the patch notes and there were elements in that they were updating stuff for the upcoming DLC.
Right. They said there were assets for upcoming DLC in there as well.
Right. Like they were updating this art asset or something like that, which says to me that it's all in there and they're just waiting to unlock it. Is that too big of a stretch to assume that?
Oh, I mean, they could also still be finishing up other things. Like, you can put the art asset in there. Maybe the story's not completely done, or there's still some scripting to work out.
Yeah, but I almost like preloading, if you will, like Steam does sometimes, like when they do a big release. But why would they do that? Why would they make a 13 gig update even bigger?
I would
why
say...
Not like, they probably reached a point where it was huge. Like, eh, fuck it, man. Let's just keep going. Just put it all in there.
You're setting a record at that point.
If they're all working through that stuff, then as things get done, then they can go, we'll just put it in this update that we're putting out anyway.
Yeah.
And that way the next update doesn't have to be as big. But I'd be very surprised if they're completely finished with them already and haven't announced them.
Yeah.
At the very least, if they're done, I would expect them to know exactly when they want to unlock them.
And I don't think that's the case. Oh, you don't think it is? Okay.
I think that I absolutely believe you that they've probably put in assets for future DLC. I don't think that necessarily means that it's the complete DLC. Yeah. I mean, I'd love to
see the tail on like DLC. Like by the time they get to the fourth and fifth one, how many people have just dropped out of that game by that point and are just not interested.
I think the people who would be interested are diehard. I feel like there is a little bit of a drop-off. Mm-hmm. Like, I think the big drop-off is from the core game to DLC,
right?
And then it's probably incremental at that point.
And I'm sure multiplayer plays a part of it, whether it's single-player campaign editions, or if there's a new game already developed, like the next iteration of the franchise has been developed, or been announced, I mean.
So that actually ties into something else that I have on my list to talk about. I guess Naughty Dog announced that this upcoming DLC will be the only story DLC they're releasing for Last of Us.
Which I find interesting, especially for Naughty Dog being a very cinematic, story-driven company.
Yeah, well, I guess the first one was multiplayer. This second one, which they've announced, is coming out on February 14th,
Valentine's Day,
so we can all have a romantic zombie holiday. And then the third one is going to be multiplayer as well. So I don't know why everyone's kind of surprised by that. They said initially that their season pass or whatever it is will contain two multiplayer and one single player. The single player, we know what that is. So why are people surprised that there's not going
to
be more?
Yeah, that leads me to the question, is there going to be any more at all? Like they said explicitly, there's not going to be any more campaign.
You think there might not be any more multiplayer either?
No, maybe not. I mean, if the season pass covered two multiplayers and one campaign, here we are at the end of it.
How big is Naughty Dog? Can they develop two AAA titles simultaneously?
It's big.
Because I know they announced they're working on a new Uncharted.
Yeah, but they also said that that's probably not going to be out this year. So it's still pretty early in development.
Okay. But that's still, I mean, they're still dedicating a team to that. Sure. So it's like, do they have enough resources to then be developing something else simultaneously?
I mean, they have a lot of people. They were what, a whole floor of a building?
They were more than that. I mean, it was huge. We got to go visit them and take a tour of the place when
they
went to VidCon. And it was just after they had released Last of Us. So it's that post-release where everyone's just gone. Mm-hmm. You know, they finally get to take a vacation after 2 years of crunch.
Right.
I'm not sure if that was their crunch. But yeah, but it was a lot of space that they had.
They also released the opening cinematic for that Left Behind DLC as well. And you can watch, I guess, the opening interaction between Ellie and Riley.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's like a 2.5 minute cinematic.
It's supposed to be pretty cute. Like, it's a little bit more lighthearted, obviously, because it's, you know, it's two, you know, young girls hanging out and bonding and this whole thing hasn't happened to Ellie yet, so it's sort of like before it gets dark.
Not to get too spoilerish, but I mean, I think, you know, the Valentine's Day release as well, I think there's an implied relationship between those two characters. I got that in the last, like towards the end of Last of Us when Ellie was talking about it.
Yeah.
Adam Baird just finished Last of Us.
So I rewatched the ending because I saw him finish it.
It's great, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. But it's like one of those things where you tell someone to play something for long enough, and then when they finally do it, they come back and tell you how great it is, and they have a lot of fun with it. So
you mean kind of like how you guys do with me in Game of Thrones.
Pretty much. I just finished I'm halfway through the fourth book now.
Okay.
Actually, for my birthday, got me a Paperwhite, like one of those Kindle Paperwhites.
Okay.
I love it. It's a front-lit but back-lit display.
So it's the display's lit, but it's lit sort of like from the front and the sides going into the paper instead of going out to your eyes, so you can read it for hours without getting eye strain.
Kindle's got that display stuff down,
man. It's pretty great.
They really do.
That e-ink or whatever they had in the first Kindle was crazy to me.
It's really cool.
Yeah.
And they've kept that this whole time. But before we get too far away from it, the Barrel at Sea, the trailer, did you guys watch it? I mean, what'd you think of it?
I haven't watched it yet.
So it's they take the multiverse thing to another extreme where they have characters from different games that are in the same room, and some characters can see the others, but others can't see them. So I would like to see their explanation of that now.
I'm sure we'll get there very quickly. We'll find out.
Yeah.
Did you guys see that people are writing that Gone Home and BioShock share the same universe?
I saw that.
Because
I guess in BioShock, or you explain it. You're actually looking at the story.
Well, yeah. I've actually got an article on Polygon pulled up, and it just says The connection links to Minerva's Den, downloadable content for Bioshock 2, a title that I guess the Gone Home guy worked on. So in the DLC, players can find a video game created in the 50s called Spitfire. Gone Home plays homage to this with Super Nintendo title Super Spitfire. Even the game's publisher, CMP Interactive, is a nod to Minerva's Den protagonist, Charles Milton Porter.
I remember picking up that Super Spitfire cartridge in Gone Home and being like, what is this?
And then he goes on to say, in a totally non-legitimate way, we very lightly imply that Bioshock takes place in the same universe as System Shock. So in theory, if you were able to make a lot of logical leaps, all those games have been linked together by our ridiculous retconning.
But I like that. He said in a non-litigious way.
Yeah.
In a don't sue us kind of a way.
Like, don't sue us, but they take place in your universe.
Okay, that leads us into another story that I think is really relevant. Gus sent out the trailer for Shadow of Mordor.
Oh, right.
The one we just watched.
The 8-minute gameplay video?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's the one that, it's an alpha code one, which is crazy.
No, it said pre-alpha code.
It's pre-alpha.
Yeah.
You're kind of kidding me.
And it's being developed by Monolith.
Monolith, right. Yeah. And who previously developed Fear? To begin with?
Fear, Matrix Online.
And several Lord of the Rings games.
I heard Matrix. Oh, do they do the RTS games that everybody loves on the Lord of the Rings?
I don't think they did those
okay.
ones.
But
I'm looking it up right now just to clarify exactly which ones they did. Because, you know, the Lord of the Rings games are spread out over mm-hmm. several. I know, for example, that they did not make Lego Lord of the Rings.
I think Good Travelers call. Has that locked down.
Nor did they make the movies. That was somebody else down in New Zealand. But this Shadow of Mordor trailer, it focuses primarily on what they call their nemesis system.
Guardians of Middle-earth. That was their last one.
Guardians of Middle-earth.
Yeah.
Oh, that was almost like the Gauntlet.
I
want to
say that was like a MOBA.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. But they showed this nemesis system, which is where it creates villains and your nemesis, basically, in your playthrough.
That are
uniquely,
unique to your playthrough, yeah.
Yeah.
So it's got character generation that's almost like procedural. Your mm-hmm. actions in the world create these nemesis who then react to you based on what you've done to them and their friends in the past.
Well, and it's cool because it also generates an entire like branching quest system for dealing with this nemesis. Like in that gameplay demo, it showed you taking control of Nemesis and then sending him off to assassinate another guy. And so by doing that, it created a series of missions, or one mission or a series of missions in that vein, so you could follow that through, follow that guy to the assassination attempt, and finish everyone off if you want.
Right. And I think even in that trailer, they acknowledge that the person you send to perform the assassination has a very low chance of success, hope to disrupt it. And
well, that guy in particular right. has a low chance of success. And you can actually, like, you can, as you're picking his assassination target, you can see what the likelihood that they'll succeed is.
Yeah.
So you can be like, oh, I better follow and make sure this all goes according to plan.
Mm-hmm.
But
it looks so cool.
To describe the game, it's basically looks like Assassin's Creed Middle Earth is what it looks like.
That is definitely the comparison.
With a
people
lot
have been
of a lot of additional layers added in, it looked like a lot of fun.
Yeah,
I have to say, it looked amazing.
I normally don't like watching teasers that are that long that for a game that's that far out. But that was definitely worth
yeah,
watching.
Yeah, that was
like 8 minutes long.
That was like a tech lecture, you know, of like, it was definitely a presentation. It wasn't even really a trailer.
It was, but I'm kind of glad they did it because, so when they announced the game, they talked about this nemesis system. They said that it would have these enemies who they get away and they can be promoted and they remember you and hold a grudge and become your personal nemesis. And it said all that in the announcement. And I was like, okay, well, that sounds kind of cool. But actually being able to see them work through the formation and use of like of a nemesis
right. well,
was really like that sort of drove it home to me.
Well,
I'm really glad they did it.
You
it was
hear
cool.
that announcement, right? When they're describing the game, and then you're afraid you're gonna get Molly nude. You're like, yeah, you're saying you're gonna
there
do this,
that.
But how's it actually
that
gonna work?
Too.
But then to actually see it in action, like coded and working is really reassuring.
Now that but there you
Poor
can
Molly,
you can
man.
Fill in some blanks.
He's become a verb.
He just became a verb for overpromising. You got Molly nude. But in the thing, though, they do make flowery promises, but really a lot of that could be scripted and the narrator is telling you what you're seeing.
True.
Like it's saying like, the nemesis will remember your previous battle and you wounded him. And he goes, and I gotta say, they nailed the voice acting. They sound like orcs and trolls from the Lord of the Rings movies. At least they nailed the voice acting as it was in the Peter Jackson movies. Like he picks him and goes, yeah, you burned my face last time. It's like, okay. And his face was burned, but it's like, that could definitely be scripted. And there, you know, there could be like four or five iterations of this. Well, but they make it sound like,
did you burn his face or did you burn his hand or did you burn his foot? Like, what's he going to say?
Well, right. I mean, I imagine that they could come up with, they could come up with a wide range of scenarios. So while it's not like, oh, you burned my little toe, you know, like down to that sort of granularity, it probably can go through and remember.
Or like, we spent a lovely evening together and now you're betraying
my
me.
Signature move.
I'm going to be that open world.
My signature move is going to be burning dicks. So if I, they let me burn the orc dicks, I'm all for it. I'm like, you burn me in the dick.
I mean, how many iterations could they possibly do? So it is, it looks very ambitious. And if they deliver on even, you know, a quarter of what's there, it'll still be a very impressive game. And it looks great for pre-alpha code.
Yeah, it looks, I mean, it is a demo, so they have that opportunity to get the gameplay mechanics in place, and then, you know, they very much, like, build the scenario, like, they only build the buildings and all that they specifically need.
It's very controlled, it and
is
very small.
It is very controlled, but they could also have possibly made their work a tiny bit easier by maybe potentially using assets from other games, like, say, Assassin's Creed 2. I don't know if you guys heard about this,
right.
but a former Ubisoft developer who worked on, I want to say it was Assassin's Creed 2, he saw that demo the day it came out and he tweeted that he recognized the assets.
Yeah.
Like some of the assets. I don't think he clarified which ones. I'm not sure if it was an animation or a plank of wood or what exactly, but he said that it looked
GameSpot like, quoted him as saying, I spent 2 years staring at Assassin's Creed 2. I know it when I see it. That's what he said.
That's it, but that's kind of that, vague. Like, what does
tenuous.
He mean?
Tenuous. I don't know. That's.
And he also wrote. He wrote apparently on Twitter or on a blog or something. He wrote, "Check it out, guys! I apparently made a Middle Earth game." And he linked to the Shadow of Mordor walkthrough. Then he followed up with a comment. I know I don't have any legal rights to what I did on Assassin's Creed 2, so he knows he doesn't. But I sure hope I get a special thanks on that Middle Earth game.
That's kind of douchey, isn't it?
Well, then you know what? Then you know what? If he's gonna, that's really passive aggressive. I don't appreciate it. I would like him to tell us what it is that he thinks he recognized.
Yeah.
Because here's the thing. He's a former developer. Let's say they are using assets from Assassin's Creed. Why couldn't they be licensed?
Yeah, or, like, how do you even grab those assets to be able to use them?
Some companies do that, some don't. Does Ubisoft ever license out their tech?
I don't know.
Epic does.
I know that... I know that Ubisoft has licensed tech from others, like the original Far Cry was built on Crytek, and actually the original Far Cry was built by Crytek. I don't know what I'm saying, but I think Far Cry, by the time I got to Far Cry 2, when Ubisoft actually developed it, they were still using the Crytek engine.
Does Ubisoft, do they distribute Crysis?
No.
So there is EA publishes Crysis.
So there is some kind of crossover there with an existing franchise. I mean, Crytek is like the Doom. You know, the tech demo, essentially game franchise for Crytek.
For the engine.
You know, so they could, like, if they decided they wanted to make an open world game and licensed whatever Assassin's Creed engine it was that made that, then who knows what comes with it.
Yeah.
But still, it's interesting to note, like, it's to see that we all look at it and we go, oh, it kind of looks like Assassin's Creed, and then go, maybe more than we realize.
Yeah, maybe there's something more there.
you really never know.
But the climbing does look very Assassin's Creed.
Yeah, I mean, it's like, you know, I mean, Assassin's Creed has that whole, like, parkour combat system down.
It is true that I feel like any game that incorporates that at this point is going to be compared to Assassin's Creed to some degree.
Mm-hmm.
But what Monolith compared it to much more was more like the Batman Arkham games, I think.
Okay. Yeah.
Which also has a lot of that scaling buildings.
Jumping down on people.
Exactly, like navigating the environment to get the drop on everyone. Mm-hmm. And that's what they want you to do in this game, too. So Assassins doesn't have exclusive rights.
So, that is your point. That, I mean, that kind of makes sense. Batman also has, like, the counter system and tackling and a lot of those same features.
Yeah. And, you know, we know that Shadow of Mordor has run into problems with this kind of thing before because their original name was Candy of Mordor Saga. So they had to change that for trademark reasons. Luckily, they were able to avoid going to court over that.
Truth. It's fucking funny.
thanks, Gus.
Speaking of...
Before we get too far off this, though, I do want to talk about something else.
Yeah.
With the Shadow of Mordor. There was always something that I wanted to play with, but I couldn't, which was the system that they used to build all the huge battles in the Lord of the Rings movies, the original trilogy.
Massive?
Massive was the name of the software system, and it's how they ran all those huge battles, like especially in Return of the King, where they didn't animate all of those. They built a system to make those battles. And then they would just run the battles and then pick the best ones And basically what they did was they programmed what they called agents, where there was a human agent and there was an orc agent. When a human gets close to an orc, it takes a swing. If it gets hit once, it fights back. If it gets hit again, it falls down and dies. Like, they would program in rules like that. And then they would just run the battles. And then if there were, like, humans that acted differently or orcs that acted wrong, like they got on top of rocks or something, they just deleted those individual agents. And then they used those. That, if that system was ever released, people would just play with that all day long.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
You'd just be recreating battles.
Just like the battle maker.
Yeah.
Just for a machinima's tool, that would be amazing.
Well, not only that, but like imagine the historical simulations you could run.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like all the different battles, you could be like, it might have looked something like this.
It's like, or, I really although, like Braveheart. I want to see what that looks like in a computer simulation.
Civil War reenactors might not appreciate that very much. Well, they've kind of got the corner on the market.
They don't have to go outside. They can stay in on the weekend. they can sell that musket.
But it'll also be a lot of fun because you could say, like, what if they didn't have... the ring race in the battle. Could they have won? You know, or what if they didn't have this?
It's almost like super nerdy fantasy football.
Oh my god!
It's like you pick your favorite agents and you put them out on the field. Like.
But when I saw them when Monolith released this video and they were talking about the Nemesis system and like all the different iterations of it, it reminded me of the Massive system and how much I wanted to always play with that. And I'm sure they're probably going to use a newer version of Massive for the next Hobbit movie for the Battle of Five Armies.
Oh, so, that's going to be enormous. Yeah. I can't wait for that.
That should be really cool.
Yeah. Here, let me read this.
All right, go ahead.
I want to remind everyone that this episode of The Patch is brought to you by Hulu Plus. You've probably tried Hulu.com. Hulu Plus is so much more. With Hulu Plus, you can watch your favorite shows anytime, anywhere. Hulu Plus lets you watch thousands of hit TV shows and movies in the living room or on the go with your smartphone or tablet. With Hulu Plus, you can watch your favorite TV shows like SNL, Jimmy Kimmel Live, Shark Tank, and Scandal. Watch every episode of shows like Lost, Law & Order SVU, Doctor Who, and Community. You can also check out exclusive content, including Hulu originals like The Wrong Mans and Behind the Mask, Hulu's new docuseries that takes you inside the world of sports mascots. You'll also get access to a collection of ad-free movies and kids content. For only $7.99 a month, catch up on current shows, binge on old favorites, or catch a great movie. Stream as many TV shows and movies as you want, wherever you want. Right now, you can try Hulu Plus free for 2 weeks when you go to huluplus.com/patch. Special offer for our listeners. Make sure you use huluplus.com/patch. Get your extended free trial. They know that we sent you. Go to huluplus.com/patch for your extended 2-week free trial.
Great and service. I always want to point out whenever we talk about Hulu on The Patch that Hulu does have an entire video game section. They feature trailers and all that. So you should definitely check it out if you get a chance.
Mm-hmm. So we were talking about licensing technology.
We were.
And one of the other big stories
they even have an Ouya section.
An Ouya section?
Yeah, latest games available on Ouya.
Didn't one of the co-founders leave Ouya just recently? Yes. I'm pretty sure he did.
I did. That's not in my list of topics, but yeah. I don't have any more information other than to agree with you.
Neither do I, but guys, the co-founder left Ouya.
So where will he go next?
We were talking about licensing. One of the big stories from the week is that Microsoft now owns the Gears of War franchise.
Yep.
They bought the franchise from Epic and are having a studio in Vancouver called Black Tusk work on the franchise now.
Yeah.
And I don't know if you remember, Black Tusk had a trailer during E3 this past year.
What was their trailer?
It wasn't for any specific game. It was just like a guy, like secret agent kind of mission thing. It was kind of futuristic. And it there was no name of a game. It just said Black Tusk Studios.
See, there was
that during the E3 announcements? During the Xbox One like big thing?
Right.
I literally don't remember that.
I don't remember it at all.
If you look it up, we'll link to it. You can watch it. It's like a 30-second.
It's called the Black Tusk Game Project E3 2013 teaser.
Well, see, here's the weird thing about that. So I actually didn't remember that at all, but Black Tusk.
We were there.
We were there. I still don't remember it. But I guess Black Tusk has been tasked with creating a new rival, like a big new franchise, like something to rival Halo level popularity.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, I guess, now in addition to the Gears of War work they're doing.
Or maybe that is the Gears of War work they're doing.
But they've also been working since like 2012. Mm-hmm. And if they've got this secret project, then I doubt they're going to halt work on it entirely.
Mm-hmm.
Unless it hasn't gone as well as expected and they just decided to drop it and now do Gears.
Ben.
Which is entirely possible. There's a lot of projects that you never actually end up hearing about because they get scrapped before they get to that point.
Yeah, but sometimes for the better. Ben, I don't know how to say his name, Ben Kuchera, formerly of the PA Report, had an article on
Polygon.
Yeah, he had an article on Polygon today talking about how excited he is about this, considering how well Microsoft did with the Halo transition from Bungie to 343, saying that he's very hopeful watching Black Tusk take over for Epic
well, and
on
they,
his franchise.
And they do have Rod Ferguson, who's going to be you know, essentially leading the project, and he did lead on Gears of War as well. He was the senior producer for 2 and the director of production for 3, and I don't know how close his relationship was on Judgment, since that was developed by their subsidiary, something human.
People Who Can
Free
Fly?
People Who Can Fly, there we go. I was like, people, humans who of has, some kind.
They've since been renamed Epic Poland. They're based out of Poland.
Yeah, so I don't know like how close it was, the development relationship was there. But, I mean, he is, you know, he's Gears as much as Cliff Bleszinski mm-hmm. ever was. So he's still going to be working on it. So that's a good sign, right? Yeah. That they've got that sort of leadership role, even if they do have new developers behind
it. I'm hopeful. You know, even though in reading these articles, I realized that, I guess, Gears of War Judgment didn't sell as well as they hoped. I think it just sold like a million copies. Judgment was a great game.
I never played it. I played
you know,
3,
that,
but
that
not...
was handled by a separate developer. Mm. And it was definitely different pacing-wise and style-wise than the other 3, but I thought it was an improvement.
Well, you know, I have to say that considering the Judgment was featuring a completely different main character, I would expect it to have a different style and different pacing. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, it's just Dom with a new skin.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
It needs to have, the game itself needs to have another personality.
Yeah, the level design was broken up a bit into like more manageable chunks, and there were some new features added in. I thought it was a really, really good game. I'm disappointed to hear it only sold a million.
I dropped out of the Gears of War franchise after 1. I mean, I thought it was a great game and I liked it a lot. It looked great on the Xbox 360. There were a lot of games that came out years later that didn't look as good as it. Mm-hmm. But I never caught up, you know. Yeah. I wonder how did Bulletstorm do?
I don't know. That's a good question.
Yeah.
Let me look that up for you.
A lot of people were pointing out that Cliffy B explicitly said, I'm not working on this. I'm not going to be working on the Gears of War franchise at Microsoft. But you have to explicitly say those things sometimes.
He was probably being asked nonstop.
He was being asked
probably
nonstop.
Had to make a statement.
He did say something about that. He said, like, people have been, you know, tweeting and asking me questions all day long. No, I'm not working on it.
Yeah. You know, and so we go back to, like, that announcement that Naughty Dog made about the multiplayer, single-player DLC. Sometimes you have to explicitly say these things so that people can point to it.
Yeah.
You know, it doesn't really like show an agenda or anything like that. It's just you gotta communicate. Otherwise, the rumor mill or you get enough tweets about it, then it just becomes like people read it enough times, they just think it's true.
Right. In his statement saying that he's not going to be working on it, he even said that, I guess, Phil Spencer from Microsoft called him a week before the news was public to let him know that this was coming and that he really appreciated it. And
Phil Spencer's a good guy.
Yeah, it seemed like it was really,
I like
really
him a lot.
Upfront kind of people.
So Bulletstorm sold just shy of a million units.
Oh, and really? That's
Epic,
impressive.
Epic blamed it on piracy. They said that was disappointing sales.
Hmm. Blamed it on piracy. Was it primarily a PC game or was it primarily a console?
No, it was on Xbox 360. It was on Xbox 360, PlayStation 3, and Windows. So I guess the Windows version sold
more on the PC?
Much lower. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Well, I guess maybe they had higher hopes for it. I mean, I think Epic is concentrating on Fortnite is everything that I've seen about that game.
That's the only game I'm aware of that they have in development.
Yeah, maybe that's why I think they're concentrating on it, because that's the only one I know
that's
about.
That's also Epic Poland working on that, I believe.
Yeah, I think that's them as well. Mm-hmm. So I'm not sure. I think Epic is maybe working on like new secret franchises, new secret projects.
Dun, dun, dun.
They've when they sold Gears of War, everyone was like, oh, does this mean Epic is getting out of the games business and just selling their engine because, you know, that's doing so well for them? And they said, no, we're working on stuff. We're working on new stuff. They're just not ready to share what it is. That's exciting.
No, that's
when
cool.
was
that's
the last really Unreal release? Unreal Tournament or just Unreal?
2004?
There was Unreal Tournament 2004, and then there was Unreal
Championship.
Unreal Championship, and I want to say there was an Unreal Championship 2, but I don't think they've released one since then. I would love a new Unreal Tournament. That was the game that I played the original with playing CTF on Facebook.
Maybe we'll see Unreal champ or an Unreal game with a single player with a story.
No.
See, that's like, dude, I feel like genre, that type of game doesn't exist anymore.
Well, they sort of had a single player on Unreal Tournament originally, but it was just like, we're going to send you into many battles against bots.
Yeah.
Have fun. Eventually you'll win the tournament.
Unreal Tournament 3 was released in 2007. I don't remember Unreal Tournament 3 that well.
There was an Unreal Tournament 3?
It had vehicles. Yeah, vehicle capture the flag.
Oh, don't we look stupid?
Yeah.
Wow.
I guess cut this out of the podcast.
I guess we really, but that's 2007. That's still coming up on like, what, 8 years ago. when that was released. Mm-hmm. So
nothing on Valve.
What's that?
Yeah, they got nothing on Valve.
That's a really good point. That's a really good point. And there's different editions of it. Like there's a Titan pack and a Black edition as well. That you know, some of those collector's editions or re-releases took it all the way up to 2009. But yeah, did you know that there was even an Unreal Championship 2?
Yeah,
she said.
Sorry.
Yeah, I was busy reading it. Missed the three, and now I'm sad with myself.
I do think, though, that an iteration of the Unreal series is long overdue.
Yeah. It's going to be another one of those games, though, that I'm going to be honest, it'll be a little bit weird without Blazinski, because he was on board with them from Unreal Tournament onwards. Like, he was one of their main level designers.
Yeah.
But I guess there's a lot of level designers in the world. So
yeah, they've got a lot of people now, I'm sure. Just, it's in good hands.
If you make a new Unreal Tournament, please do Facing Worlds.
That's like probably the number one most requested feature or map for Unreal.
I really hope so. It was so good.
Yeah. And you know, if they ever make a new Jazz Jackrabbit, they gotta get Cliffy B back for that.
I think he would come back for that one.
But last release in 1994. They definitely need an update
for that and Commander Keen.
Can I tell you, though, when she talks about Facing Worlds, you know how you have, like, seminal moments in your video game career? Like, you can remember specific things.
Mm-hmm.
Are there big ones for you that, like, stand out? Like, I finally did this, or I beat this game, and it, like, stands out for you?
God, I'm sure there's so many. None that really stand out, but, I mean, that happens, yeah.
I had one this last weekend, and I can't believe it's going to be one that I remember for a long time. So, Ashley had never played Minecraft before,
okay,
ever. And I hadn't played Minecraft. I've never played Minecraft on a console. And by the way, a little bit relevant to current events, they just announced that Minecraft has sold now 1 million units on PS3.
Yeah,
they
can just port it to a new platform and print money.
Minecraft might be the new Tetris. That they just, like, every time they make a new console, they will make Minecraft.
Except the creator actually makes money off it.
Oh. Yeah. Where does the money for Tetris go? Is it just public KGB. Domain, or it just goes to the KGB. Russian government?
No, I don't know.
Probably a stack of checks in some Russian office. There's like $10 billion worth of checks for all the Tetris iterations.
If you ever name your child like Mr. Tetris, you can redeem all the checks.
But or if you beat Vladimir Putin in an arm wrestling competition, then you get it. But we were playing Minecraft. She'd never played Minecraft before, and I only played on PC, so we were playing it on PC. And it's also cross-platform with Mac. That game's so easy. Like, she's got a world.
Amazing.
She just hits open this world to the LAN, and then you can just join her game. Mm-hmm. It's, like, super easy. So we were all playing. We had four stations set up. It was us and the boys, and we were playing on my birthday weekend. We played a bunch of Minecraft.
That's all we did.
And then we were playing ourselves, keeping our world going, and we were, like, getting into, like, farming and livestock herding and stuff. Then we found out we were in a jungle biome. I saw a cat, and I didn't know there were cats in Minecraft because mm-hmm. I dropped out before they'd updated that. I'm not gonna lie, you could tame a cat. It took me 3 hours to tame a cat. And when I finally tamed the cat, you're like, I'm like creeping through this jungle with a raw fish in my hands, like this, following this cat. And it finally comes up to me, and I feed it the fish and feed it the fish, and it goes from like a wild, like leopard texture to like a house cat.
Right.
And when it made that change, it was like, I'm going to remember this moment. It stuck with me.
He
taming
was
a cat.
So proud. He was
so
proud.
Oh, so happy.
And then he went away. He had to go to Florida. And so I dropped him off at the airport, and I came back, and I was like, I'm going to get a cat. It took, in terms of Minecraft, it took days and days. Because I guess it's a super rare spawn, and it, like, if it gets too far away from you, it despawns. I learned a lot about this.
They're very skittish. They run. If you move your mouse too quickly and you look too fast, they run mm-hmm. away from that.
Are you going to become a crazy cat lady and just have a bunch of cats in your house?
Well, now we can breed them.
Yeah. Oh, now we each have a cat. So mine turned into a Joe the Cat, which is brilliant. I'm so happy.
She actually has a cat, Siamese cat, and I have Joe the Cat, although Joe the Cat is now her cat, honestly.
Oh, look, there's
the cat. Yeah, she got Joe the Cat.
Joe the Cat.
So she has a Joe the Cat in the game of Minecraft.
You got to find like a device to port Minecraft to so Joe the Cat can join you in his kitty version of Minecraft.
He probably will. He does.
He sits on my lap while we play.
I love that the I mean, everyone's kind of, I don't know if people are sick to death of Minecraft yet or not, but the behaviors the behaviors that they have programmed into the cat are really funny. Like, if you light the furnace, it goes and sits on top of the burning furnace, and it'll, like, they all sit on the bed if you have a bed in the room and stuff like that, or
and
sit,
they'll
in, the
sit in the windows.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like it's, you saw Joe in that picture was sitting on the window.
It's
so
super cute.
Nice.
Yeah,
it's like, I don't know what all I'm gonna do to be happier. I'm gonna get a horse. I'm gonna get a wolf, and then I'm just gonna be like Lord of the Animals, just like riding through my Minecraft world.
I do hope they continue to update the game. That would be great. Like, if they just add little things now and then, because that game is so complex now.
Pet goldfish?
Just throwing it out there.
Pet Squid.
I'm sure they'll keep adding. I mean, they sold another million copies on PS3. When it comes out on PS4 and Xbox One, it's going to be another couple million. I mean, why not?
But I'll tell you why not, because now that becomes the problem, right? Where as they have multiple platforms, a patch now is, it's a multiplier effect. Now it's really, really hard to have across all these different platforms update the patch. You got to update Pocket Edition. Mm-hmm. You got to update PC and Mac. You got to update PS3. You got to update Xbox 360. Then the next gen consoles.
Is the Pocket Edition developed by 4J or is that developed by someone else?
That's a good question.
Because I know that 4J said that now that the PS3 edition has been released, they'll be updating it in parallel with the 360 version.
Yeah.
And I imagine that it will be a very similar process with the next gen versions as well. Mm-hmm. So I wonder if they're able to find enough common ground that the rework isn't a huge deal. But the Pocket Edition...
As long as they stay on it. I mean, why would they stay around working on a franchise just making patches every now and then?
Money.
Lots of money. According to...
But then they do skin packs.
According to the App Store, Pocket Edition is developed by Mojang. It doesn't say 4J.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure they probably had some developer. I'll tell you a crazy story. I was coming back from Miami from the trip, and I was sitting one row back on the plane in the aisle, and across from a kid who had an iPad where he's playing Pocket Minecraft,
mm-hmm.
and I had just been playing it recently, so I was like, oh, it's kind of cool, he's playing Pocket Minecraft. I watched the kid for 5 minutes, all he did was kill animals. That's all he did for 5 minutes, and I wanted to like go to his parents and say like, hey, you should really talk to your kid. I've watched him kill like 80 sheep for no reason at all. It was a little creepy, I have to admit.
That's like the game to him, it's like, to be the only creature in the world.
And how old was this kid?
He was like 10 or 11, yeah, and he was pretty, you know, good with the touch controls.
That's like how serial killers start, right?
Yeah. Yeah. If he had started to gather them into pens and breed them to kill them, then that would have been...
Or build a killing machine so that as they're born, they automatically get killed.
Pushes them off cliffs. Yeah. Jeez, it was a little disturbing, I have to admit.
Well, I don't know. Who knows? Maybe he was just trying to get enough food that he would never have to worry about it again.
Yeah, but maybe so. Ever again. But it is really fun to introduce somebody to Minecraft, even though the game's been around for now 4 or 5 years. Introduce somebody to watch it and watch how it just like it bites them, mm-hmm. you know, and it just takes hold of them.
It was actually like it was surprising. It's been one of those games for me that it's around. Everyone talks about it. Mm-hmm. I've seen screenshots of all these amazing worlds people build. You know, the achievement hunters have all these super elaborate Let's Plays that they do, and it just becomes sort of this part of a cultural conversation. But for me, it's almost like Pokemon, which I didn't even play until X came out, because it's one of those things that I hear about it so much, and I've absorbed it into, like, so I'm like, oh, yeah, sure, I know what that is.
Mm-hmm. You feel like you've already played it?
Yeah, to some degree, I feel like I've already played it. And I don't feel like the driving need to play it for some reason. It's a weird sort of, like, almost I feel like it's passed me by.
Yeah. Well, it's also, I mean, like you said, it's like so it's part late. Of culture. You don't want to feel left out. Even though you know about it and you see videos and you hear about it, it's also a different experience to actually go in and play it yourself.
Wait till she sees the console version of it. She's such a snob when it comes to the books with Game of Thrones.
Mm-hmm.
That's going to apply to you with Minecraft PC. When you see the console, they have all the recipes where you just scroll through them and just select what you want to make. You don't have to know the recipes.
Perfect reaction.
That's half the fun, though. Like, I will say that he drops me into this randomly generated world, and he'd gone through, and he was really sweet about it. He found a nice, like, a seed that looked like it had a lot of really cool stuff, and he went and generated the world, and we went into it, and he was like, well, this doesn't look like what I generated. And it turns out that was because it was like a beta version from 2011. So we have no idea what this world just generated. It's actually a complete mystery.
Oh, it's like you're running like a super old version?
Yeah.
No. The coda, the seed I got was for an older version.
Oh, I see. Yeah. I see. Okay.
And so he's like, all right, so now you'll want to chop down this tree and you're going to need to make an axe and do this stuff, get a whole bunch of wood. All right, now night is coming and you're going to need to do this. You're going to need to make a shelter. I don't mind telling you, I got so stressed out that first night, mm-hmm. hearing stuff out there. The sun was going down, and I was terrified. Things are going to come for me. I've got a wood axe.
Yeah.
It was like just, it really got into my like sort of like human caveman instincts.
Yeah. The first day is always a race. It's like, am I going to get enough shit to?
It's cold, basically,
to get through this. Yeah.
Yeah, I basically just like had to like bury myself, and then just like wait.
But so if you haven't heard of this game, it's called Minecraft. You should check it out. With its,
it's an indie game. You might not have heard of it.
Developer, so help them out. It's in pre-release right now. Early access.
No, they finally released.
No, I'm just kidding. Yeah. I'm just kidding.
Do you consider?
I'm just talking about how slowpoke we are. This is welcome to the patch 2010.
is 1.0? That's like when release. Developers finally decide mm-hmm. to give something a 1.0. That's release.
There's a box version of Minecraft out there that I imagine will be worth some money someday.
A box version, mm-hmm. like
on the shelf, comes in a box.
Interesting. Wow. I've never seen that.
Yeah.
I've seen the cards, like the digital codes you can buy to get the game.
I do think it's really interesting, and you pointed this out, that Minecraft isn't on Steam. That's where I would, like, when I was going to go ahead and give it a try, that's where I would have gone to look for it. No, not there. They don't need...
I guess, why would they give a cut to Valve?
Yo, yeah. We don't need this.
They probably got enough of a fan base early on, they just keep distributing it themselves.
Yeah, I mean, and it's been popular since almost before the rise of Steam. Not since Steam has been out, because Steam's been out for a really long time, mm-hmm. but since Steam...
really took off?
Yeah. Gained momentum. Gained yep. some Steam.
Oh, ha. You've been hanging out with Barbara too much. Also, there was other news this week. I guess Respawn announced that the 360 version of Titanfall is being developed by a different studio. Is it Bluepoint?
Yeah, Bluepoint. They're an Austin-based developer.
Oh, are they? I didn't know that.
Yep. I looked them up. It said in the article that you sent out, it said it was a, let me see if I can quote this. This is a joystick article. It said they're a Texas-based developer, but they're actually here in Austin.
Oh, okay.
Woo-hoo,
and I
Uncle
looked
Austin.
Them up. They had worked on a lot of really cool stuff. They did a lot of ports for PlayStation first-party Sony titles. Like, they did Ico. Is Ico first-party? I guess maybe not.
Yeah. Wait. I thought it was.
But they did Ico, Shadow of the Colossus.
Did they do the HD remake, maybe?
Yes.
Okay, I was going to say, I was going to get really confused because I don't think Ico came out for any other platforms. What were they porting?
Yeah, they probably did the
But that
the
makes
PS3
a lot
version.
Of sense.
But they also did the PS4 and Vita ports of Flower, which I consider to be
okay.
like a very,
wow.
that's a very unique, specific Sony game mm-hmm. or PlayStation
Absolutely.
Game that if they trusted them with that, I had not previously heard of Bluepoint specifically, but yeah,
well,
they're based here.
There's
in
a lot of studios that make a name for themselves like that, where it's like they don't necessarily develop their own property. They take other people's property and then port it or contribute and add polish to it. Like Certain Affinity is very similar in the same way. They're also Austin-based.
Yeah.
And most people may not have heard of them if they don't sit through video game credits, but they work on Call of Duty games. They work on Halo.
They ported
on...
Left 4 Dead.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they were the guys who ported Left 4 Dead to the Xbox 360.
Mm-hmm.
And they've worked on a lot of like major franchises, making them even better. Mm-hmm. You know,
well, and wasn't
we're big
it...
fans of Certain Affinity, Rooster Teeth. So,
and wasn't it so? And the Tomb Raider Definitive Edition was ported to the PS4 and Xbox One by completely different companies.
Oh, really?
Yeah, yeah.
That's
they were.
Weird.
They
okay.
were, which you know could. Possibly, I guess, contribute to why the frame rate is different on the two.
Mm-hmm.
Aside from all the like, Xbox One.
Stir up the fanboys.
Blah, blah, blah.
Stir up the console war.
Is the 360 release date for Titanfall the same as the Xbox One?
Yeah, I want to say it's coming out
March
for
11th?
All of them
yeah.
on March 11th.
Pre-order on the Xbox and be the first to get it on March 11th, yeah. That's interesting. If you were Microsoft, would you make it exclusive to the Xbox One for a window? Even away from the 360?
Well, they did that even with Spartan Assault.
I wouldn't on this one. And the reason that I wouldn't on this one is because this is it's a new IP for the studio, and they want to try and build it as much as they need to try and get as much momentum as possible. You know, they've already said that they don't expect it to do well as an established franchise like a Call of Duty or a Halo, mm-hmm. but they want it to do well so that they can then go on to make an Xbox One exclusive, probably.
I think that Titanfall. And Infamous Second Son for the PlayStation 4. I think those coming along and those being in the pipeline, I now feel...
Titanfall?
No, I'm saying Titanfall for the Xbox One
okay.
and Infamous Second Son for PlayStation 4. I think those two things being in the pipeline, those feel like, okay, here we go. Now we're starting to get those
but
next gen releases.
It's the big games post-launch that you're looking for. Yeah.
It is. I'm excited for Infamous Second Son.
They
like
just put
every,
out a video this week, didn't they?
Yeah, it was a really cool video. It was just showing how they sort of digitized Seattle. It looks gorgeous. Like there's like every time I see something for Infamous Second Son, and I don't know a lot about the Infamous series in general. I know that, you know, this guy's gonna absorb neon powers and then be able to use them, and that sounds pretty cool. But that's really the extent of what I know about the series itself. So every time I see something about this, coming into it just like with totally new eyes, looks amazing.
Yeah,
I just get more and more excited. I wish it had come out at launch.
Yeah.
I wish it had been like that one launch title that just like blows you away, because we haven't used the PS4 very much.
Have we used Contrast? The Xbox One all that much, though, either?
Well, you've been playing Left 4 Dead. Dead Rising 3.
Jesus. Come on.
Mixing up my zombie games. And
now you're in trouble for calling Left 4 Dead a
zombie. I'm in so much trouble.
They're not zombies. They're infected.
Well, yeah, but you could
no,
say...
It's totally fine. It's totally okay. Fine to call it...
You're with friends here.
It's a safe place.
So you've been playing on Dead Rising 3 and some Peggle... And Xbox One, I think that's what I started playing Assassin's Creed 4 on.
Right.
The
other day, I had the next-gen experience I think that they want me to have, where I was just kind of grinding out some of the zombie killing on Dead Rising 3, and in a snap window, I put Netflix, and I was watching Jack Reacher, the Tom Cruise movie, or something, and I had it in a snap window. That was actually pretty cool. Because I had a little Netflix window playing a movie, and I'm like just grinding it out.
I wish there was a way to control the volume of the two windows independently.
I had to lower in the options for Dead Rising 3. I had to lower all that stuff down.
You got to balance it in menu instead of toggling. I don't know how you would do it.
Otherwise,
Jack Reacher had
the weirdest background extra. And I'll be honest, it's still not entirely clear to me, like when I have two snap windows, like which one I'm controlling, and I just want to. Go over to this one and pause, but I just do all that with voice commands now.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's a little bit easier.
It's interesting. It's really, really, it's out there. It's getting there.
I can't wait until they update the interface on the Xbox One. The overall UI, like, what do they call that usually? The dashboard?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And it needs a little more polish.
Need a little bit of help. People gave me comments of, like, pinning stuff, and that really does help.
Yeah, that's what I do. Anything I use... Anything I know I'm going to use frequently, I pin it, because otherwise I'm like, oh, where the fuck is it? Mm-hmm. So dig down to menu, there it is.
Yeah, they have started making some updates. Like, you were saying right after it launched how you'd go into the store and you couldn't get back up to the higher categories and you couldn't specify which store you were going into.
Wasn't it
storing
into movies? I couldn't get back up into games.
Then you also said that they've updated that. So they are making, you know, small incremental improvements. But I'm excited to see what the first big update does. Mm-hmm.
That reminds me, on PlayStation Plus, I think January freebies for PlayStation Plus have been revealed. This is an earlier article, but Brothers, A Tale of Two Sons, which we talked about in the Game of Your Podcast.
Game.
That's one of the free games for PlayStation Plus this month.
You should absolutely play it.
Yeah, that was so good. And it's not a long game. It's very much like Journey in that it's a very short, it's just an experience. Mm-hmm. You just get completely lost in it.
It's like 3 hours.
Yeah, it's like 3 hours.
There's a new website. Well, I don't know how new it is. There's a new website to me that I've started using. I think I forget what the domain is. We'll link it. I think it's something like howlongtobeat.com. And you type in a game name and it tells you like median time to beat the game, median time to get 100% completion, median time.
Really?
Yeah, to do all the missions and side quests. And it breaks it all down and people like submit their different times and you can see about how long of a time commitment that game is going to be for you.
Oh, that's cool. One of the things I like about the Kindle that I got is it tells me how many minutes I have left in my current chapter. Or in the whole book, which is just depressing. And then I try to, like, read faster so I can make the Kindle more impressed by my reading speed. But, man, PlayStation Plus games for January, Brothers, A Tale of Two Sons, Devil May Cry, Don't Starve, and BioShock Infinite is a free game in January.
PlayStation Plus has always done a really great job of offering new-ish games for free as opposed to when Xbox Live started doing the free games with gold or whatever it is they call that program, they were like, here's your Xbox 360 or your Xbox 360 launch title. Here, you can get Cameo.
I think the first one they did for that was Halo 3. Halo 3 was one of the first big ones they did.
I think Halo 3 was the second.
Yeah, it was one of the big ones they did.
Yeah.
And it's like, sure, it is a major franchise, but at that point I think it was like a six-year-old game. And I kind of thought, well, maybe Microsoft will be just working through their back catalog, you know, because they started the service. You're not going to want to start with newer games and work back to older games, but yeah, we're not. I'm still waiting for them to catch up.
They have improved.
Yeah, they did Sleeping Dogs in December. And I picked up Sleeping Dogs that way. I still haven't played it, but I got it.
So you were right. The site is howlongtobeat.com.
Yeah, it's really handy. I use it all the time now.
Ray would break that site. Ray's gotten super into speedruns lately.
Yeah.
I don't think he does them himself, but he watches
them. Main story, 3 hours. Completionist, 3.5.
That's where I got my 3-hour figure from. I remember looking it up on there. Now, whenever I get into a game, I want to know exactly what I'm getting into.
That's really cool, actually. I like knowing that.
Great idea. I can't believe no one had done it sooner. So there was another news story this week, I guess, saying that League of Legends now has 27 million players a day.
So crazy.
What?
Which is fucking huge.
It's like three New Yorks.
Yeah. All fighting, MOBA style.
Wow. That's crazy.
And I guess there was another bit of news where the UK porn filter was blocking a League of Legends update because in the URL, it just so happened that like a file name and a domain name came together and had the letters S-E-X.
I think it was chains extended. So the S in chains and the extended right. made the word sex.
Wow, really?
So yeah, you couldn't patch unless you disabled the
just,
UK
so
filter.
Just because the word sex is in the URL.
Mm-hmm.
It's
not
blocked.
Even the word sex. It was just that the letters S, E, and X were close to each
right,
other.
Right, right, right.
Yeah, you know, that's, I mean, just the fact that we're talking about the UK porn filter, that's a really weird thing to me.
Mm-hmm.
And it, like that it would catch something like this. There's a UK porn filter.
Well, here's another weird thing about that is, isn't the UK always been much more comfortable with, like, sexual content than violent content? That's why, that's one of the things where the US is different to most other regions is
typically
the US is super strict about sexual content in like all forms of entertainment of all kinds,
mm-hmm.
Or advertising, but open to violence. And most other regions are open to sexual content, but not violence. Mm-hmm. So, and yet they have a porn filter that's so strict that if the words SEX are next to each other in a URL, it's blocked.
Yeah, the way to fix it, I guess it only affects, it's a new program, and it only affects anyone who signed up for a new ISP in this month, and the fix is to call your ISP and ask them to unblock porn. So you literally have to call and be like, can you turn the porn filter off?
I can't download my League of Legends update.
Oh, no, yeah, right, sure. Wink. There you go, download your updates.
I have a very specific porn I like. It's a 27 million group thing. I'm into really specific stuff.
It is multiplayer, I suppose.
Exactly right. Taking that definition to its most extreme possible literal interpretation. All right, let me see. 12 million players daily, 7.5 million users. It doesn't have the name of the thing here.
What are you looking for? The name?
The name of the actual file.
Oh, I had it.
Yeah, it was like chains extended or something.
There were two different ones. It was, it's right here. I have all the images, but okay, it's something Xerth Mage chains extended.
Yep.
.luaobg, and there's another one, Varus expiration timer.
So there's two of them.
There's two files.
Scandalous. How dare they put this in there?
Two sexes in the League of Legends update.
Wow.
It's a very sexy game.
Yeah.
Wow.
We should be protecting our children from that. in other news, there was a Dreamcast title that finally launched this week.
By the way, I want to congratulate you on actually trying to pronounce a League of Legends champion's name.
I know.
Wait,
that can be one of the most dangerous things you can do.
I started, I was like, oh shit, I'm fucked.
You know what I like though is every time I go to look up how to pronounce one, no one ever seems to agree.
Right.
Like there was one that I want to say was like, yeah, they'll just tell you that it's wrong no matter what. There was one, it looked like severe or siver, and all these people are like, how do you pronounce? And it's like, well, some people are like, Seaver, and some people are like severe, and some people are like Seaver.
Or others, you know, just like all these things. Shut the fuck up.
And but here's the funny thing is people trying to because it tends to be on message boards for the most part, so people are trying to explain pronunciations in text.
Mm-hmm.
It's really tough.
Yeah,
there was what was the tournament they had for League of Legends, or was a release they did where they had to remove every single female champion except for one. Do you remember that?
I don't know. No.
I don't remember that.
I'll look it up while you guys talk about something else.
What, was it because of their outfits?
It was where they were playing the game. I want to say. I'll let me look it up I'm not. Yeah.
So I'll talk about this. This is just a quick note. So it was a Dreamcast space shooter called Redux Dark Matters, which was a Kickstarter game, which has launched now almost 15 years after the Dreamcast came out. Like, so it was a Kickstarter game. They raised $53,000.
That's actually really cool.
And,
I like that.
And you can get it. Yeah. Really? It's like a side-scrolling shooter, shooter.
Look, if people on Kickstarter are going to say, yes, I'd love a new Dreamcast game, here's my money. And they say, okay, we've made this new Dreamcast game with your money. Here you go.
Sure, okay.
Like, I mean, come on. Like, yeah. Everyone wins. They got to make the Dreamcast game they wanted to make, and the people who wanted it got it.
Is it easier to develop a Dreamcast game today? I mean, it seems like it'd be way harder to develop for Dreamcast.
That's a good question. Well, Dreamcast always suffered from that problem where the bootloader got out. Like, I guess they could set up I don't know. They got to be able to do it with the bootloader because you could emulate other stuff anyway. So even if you don't have an actual Dreamcast debug kit, you could code your own software for it.
Did you guys hear about the Nintendo cartridge? The super, super rare one. It was like for World Championship. It ended up selling for $100,000 on
eBay. And it was a pretty lousy version of it. Like, it was all like waterlogged and ripped to shit.
Yeah, the buyer backed out. Terrible.
Saying it was a mistake. Yeah.
Oh, man. Are you kidding
me? Oh, yeah. Buyer claims mistake.
What mistake?
He was just bidding on it because I'm sure it's like some fucking kid who's bidding on it to see it go up.
Oh my god.
But it's still like, this is such a rare game of only one of 116 cartridges ever manufactured.
There's starting to be some
Nintendo World Championship was designed for a 1990 US contest.
There's starting to be some worrying about that because
that it's not real.
Well, that cartridge came out and then three others also came out on eBay this week as well. So people are starting to suspect that there might be a larger cache than 116 out there.
I can see that, but I could also see someone going, I could get $100,000 for this little thing.
Right.
Why not?
I mean, if you can counterfeit that, I mean, for $100,000, or they could just counterfeit it too. I mean,
there may be a factory pumping these out now.
I mean, you will notice that you can't actually see anything on the label because the label is almost entirely destroyed.
Mm-hmm. There have been other ones that
destroyed. It's not partially destroyed.
No, it says Mario.
It says it's got Mario written someone on wrote it in like pen.
Oh, I see. Yeah.
Mario, as some people here would say.
So I want to go back to my point. I finally found it. League of Legends female characters wear revealing outfits. This is from Kotaku. Yeah. Too revealing for Iranian hardliners, and thus too revealing for an Iranian esports tournament. According to Iran's World Cyber Games Facebook page, the tournament has banned female League of Legends characters. They were banned to comply with Iranian customs. So there was a tournament in Iran, and they wouldn't let you use any female League of Legends characters.
Hmm.
So, yeah, so it's... You know,
I wonder.
So Iran and UK, you guys are right there with progressiveness.
I wonder if they'll do a thing like where in World of Warcraft, in the Chinese version, some of the assets are different than in the North American version. And if they'll have a localized version for regions like that, that do comply with their requirements.
I can see that. I mean, I don't know that Riot's going to go to, you know, that amount of effort to like reskin all of their heroes or like all of their champions. Sorry. for the one region. Although they do already build like a ton of skins for all their champions, mm-hmm. They could maybe limit it.
Well, yeah, clearly, if they're trying to sneak porn in their file title.
But here's the other thing, though, about that is that so much of their, almost all of their business is based on you being able to buy different skins. What are they going to do? Make an entire suite of skins just for this region?
Yeah. I mean, I could see them putting a little bit of work into it if the market is big enough. But I feel like this market might be kind of small for them in the overall picture. So maybe they won't dedicate too many resources.
I mean, also, they already print money. They made $624 million last year. Hurting for it.
I have to say, if I was creating something and somebody came to me and said, hey, you have to change your game for our market, and I didn't agree with the reasons behind the change, I would give a limited experience to that market. I think the only way you're going to affect change on a bigger level is to say, look, we're not gonna comply with this. You can either take the game as it is, or we're gonna remove those characters. If you know, maybe might make you know that concession, mm-hmm. But then the people there get a lesser experience, and this is what you get for the laws in your country, which mm-hmm. You know, supposedly you have some say in how those laws are created and made.
That's a really good point.
Theoretically,
but it's also not at all uncommon to change from a Japanese to a Western release. Just recently, Bravely Default had a whole bunch of a couple outfits that were changed from their Japanese version to their Western version. And honestly, the Japanese version like wasn't even a huge deal. Mm-hmm. There was one that was like a chicken, like a bikini with like a chaps kind of thing, I think. And they changed it to like a bandeau top and shorts. And then there was another outfit that was, it basically looked like a whole lot of straps, which frankly looks uncomfortable and not all that, you know, efficient for battle. But you know, it was like everything was covered, but then they went and put a black bodysuit underneath it anyway. Mm-hmm. Really weird, not huge changes, but that is not an uncommon thing for different regions.
I'm actually kind of glad. Oh, no, go ahead. Yeah, I didn't realize you had more to say.
Oh, sorry. But, you know, coming to like the entire Western market for Europe and the US is a little bit bigger than Iran.
I'm glad you brought up Bravely Default. Because I read something about it recently. This game has really piqued my interest. I like RPGs. I played quite a bit of JRPGs. I was not planning on picking up Bravely Default, but I saw that they have an option you can set where you can turn off random encounters. You can set random encounters to be normal, to occur 100% more frequently, or to occur 0% of the time.
You know what that sounds like to me? That sounds like Yes, I would like to grind for a while.
Yeah.
No, I'm done grinding. Right. Thank you.
Exactly. I mean, I understand the need for the random encounters, you know, to grant you experience and items and currency in the game. But once you get to a certain point, you just want to, you're done with it. You know, there's no need for it anymore. It's a relic. It's a holdover from old days. And I'm glad to see this option in the game.
It did always get annoying in Final Fantasy. You get like, you max out your levels for your entire party and you've got all this stuff. You're still fighting dudes. Although, I mean, I guess in most JRPGs, you can get items that will reduce or remove random encounters.
Mm, yeah. Well, here it's just a setting. You don't have to go through that. Well, we're at time. We got
to
wrap up
here. We got two more things to talk about.
Two more things, which
I think would be relevant.
Speed round.
You guys were talking about Steam machines being upgradable. They had to they announced this. And you guys were talking about
the Alienware
Steam machine. The Alienware one.
The Alienware. That they're saying that it will be upgradable.
Well, I think, is it upgradable or is it you can go ahead and you can change parts out if you want?
I think that's what they're saying. It's just saying it's a PC.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it depends on how they build it. Like, you know, you've got a MacBook Air here. All the components are soldered to the motherboard. Like, sure. You could never upgrade this machine. You could never upgrade this machine. You know, if they built a Steam machine like that where everything's soldered to the motherboard, then yeah, you could never do it. But this one, you might be able to get in there and swap out a few things.
And I don't think Steam machines have any kind of restriction on the size of them. Like, that's not part of the spec for a Steam machine in any way, is it? Are we calling them Steam machines or Steam boxes?
Before they were actually announced, everyone called them Steam box.
Yeah.
So now
but
it's confusing.
Now, yeah, so it's confusing. They're the same thing.
Steam machine. Okay. Just want to make sure I'm not naming a vacuum, basically. But I think it goes back to what we were saying earlier, that sometimes you have to explicitly say stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Like, even though they're like, well, why would they say this? But because probably people are saying, well, they're assuming it's a console, so you don't upgrade consoles, so you won't be able to upgrade Steam machines.
Alienware has previously said that you could not upgrade their Steam machine.
Really?
Yeah. And so now that's why they're saying this, to clarify that, wait, you can upgrade
it.
So there's a mixed message.
For some of these, I wouldn't want to be able to upgrade it.
People need to get, I feel like this is kind of a misstep. You know, you need to get your message
straight the first
time. And tell it as it is. You know, this going back and forth gives consumers, makes them worry. Like, what are you really getting?
Well, especially when the message is part of we're going to a uniform spec. Mm-hmm. Like, this is what the Steam machine is supposed to be. It's supposed to be kind of a black box for everybody, you know, to be able to buy. And it's more of a console experience.
Yeah, I mean, well, and the Steam machine thing with all of the different options, like all the different makers and all the different things that you can get, that's already confusing enough without having mixed messaging from the individual manufacturers on top of it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and like, here's how it works and here's what they can run. Like, it's all a little bit confusing if you're not already a PC devotee, which I feel like is sort of what Steam Machine is aimed at. It's aimed for people who don't already have monster gaming machines.
And what is the Steam Machine initiative if it's not a standardization? I mean, we already have PCs that run Steam.
There's really no standardization here in the Steam machine. I don't feel like that's part of their strategy.
But what is it then? Why have a class of machines called the Steam machine?
We've been asking ourselves that question for a long time. Let us know if we figure it out.
I see it as an attempt to have some kind of standardization across the PC market.
With no standard hardware.
With no standard hardware and
just
no
a standard name.
Specs. Okay. Last item, Neil Blomkamp is rumored to be directing the upcoming Halo TV pilot.
Yes.
I don't believe that for a moment.
It's definitely one of the things from the rumor mill.
I don't believe it. Yeah. I think that Neil Blomkamp, the guy who was originally going to direct the Halo movie when it was between Universal and Fox.
Universal, I thought.
Yeah. It was two studios coming together to make it. And that everything I've read from that dude, that was such a negative experience and one of his first experiences in Hollywood, I can't imagine he would go back to directing Halo. But if he does, I'll be very happy.
Well, he said as much. He said he wouldn't go back in 2009. He was like, yeah, I don't. That was horrific. But last year, I think when he was promoting Elysium, he was like, you know, I do really love the Halo world and the mythos and all that sort of stuff. The issue that he had a big problem with was, I guess, there's Universal and there's Fox and they're like, let's make it a big shoot 'em up, and there's Microsoft going, we want it to really reflect the game, and no one could decide exactly what it was supposed to be, and they had all these people making all these changes, and he had no control whatsoever. And he said that's what he had. Like, that's why it was such a negative experience for him. And if he had control, he said he would like to be able to do the movie.
Well, maybe then these circumstances are good to what he wants. I mean, if you look at what Microsoft did with Ford Unto Dawn, you know, they didn't have all these external factors pressuring them. They made what they wanted to make.
And it was amazing.
Right, and it turned out really, really well. So I still don't believe this rumor, but it's out there.
Right.
It came from the very credible Latino Review.
No, no, actually, they have posted stuff. I first heard about Latino Review when they were posting concept art from the Halo movie.
I know. I have no idea who these guys are.
I don't know.
But they get big scoops.
They really
scoops.
Like
they,
Halo.
They do get big scoops every now and then.
In his, there was a quote from Neil Blomkamp, which we referred to the Halo movie as a clusterfuck from day one. So, yeah, that'd be interesting to see. Yeah.
Okay. Well, it's time to wrap up.
Okay. Yeah.
So thanks everyone for watching and listening. We'll be back on Monday with another episode of RT Podcast and next Wednesday with another episode of The Patch.
And if you're watching from the UK, sorry about all the sex talk.
SEX.